It's not that unusual when everything is beautiful. It's just another ordinary miracle today. The sky knows when it's time to snow. Don't need to teach a seed to grow. It's just another ordinary miracle today. Life is like a gift they say, wrapped up falling away from today. Oh, I can find a way. Yes, I'm on the road. Isn't it remarkable? Like every time a raindrop falls, it's just another ordinary miracle today. Birds in winter have their play, but always make it home by spring. It's just another ordinary miracle today. When you wake up every day, please don't throw your dreams away. Hold them close to your heart, 'cause we are all
And here we are again. Good morning. This is It's All in Your Head with Dr. Paul Swingle. We had several requests for a webcast topic about neurotherapy in general. Normally, we discuss a specific condition and talk about how neurotherapy can be useful to treat the condition. However, many people told us they know someone who would benefit from neurotherapeutic treatments for different reasons and suggested to create a topic that would explain how neurotherapy works in general. And this is exactly what we are going to do today. My name is Rita, I'm the moderator, and Dr. Swingle is here to describe what neurotherapy is and how it can benefit many people out there. So make yourself comfortable and listen up. Also, feel free to send me questions or comments at any time during this webcast through the chat feature located on the control panel, and we will address these during our breaks. And a little bit about Dr. Swingel. He was titular full professor of psychology at the University of Ottawa prior to moving to Vancouver. Fellow of the Canadian Psychological Association, Dr. Swingel was lecturer in psychiatry at Harvard Medical School, attending psychologist at McLean's Hospital, where he also was coordinator of the Clinical Psychophysiology Service. Dr. Swingel is registered psychologist in British Columbia, certified in biofeedback and neurotherapy. His book, Biofeedback for the Brain, was published by Rutgers University Press. The book is available at www.soundhealthproducts.com. Again, that is www.soundhealthproducts.com. Okay, I think it's time to bring Dr. Swingel in, and here he is. Welcome, Dr. Swingel, and good morning.
Good morning. Well, today we're going to go over some of the details of the field referred to as neurotherapy, which is basically having a look at how the brain functions, looking for areas of inefficiency, and then using a variety of different techniques to normalize brain function. Now, the first thing that I really want to go over is what's indicated in this slide. Neurotherapy, in the United States at least, the equipment is all FDA certified and compliant, and you must have be a registered, certified, licensed healthcare provider in order to get access or to prescribe that the equipment. In other jurisdictions, and also in the United States as well, we have a lot of individuals who have decided they're bored selling perfume or used cars and decide they want to go into working on people's brains. And it always astonishes me when I have folks come in who have gone to one of these one-size-fits-all franchises with somebody who has a degree in fine arts or business administration and has decided to buy a franchise. And that's captured in that statement, who's working on your brain? I really like, in some cultures, the meaning of a sentence is based on the inflection, like who's working on your brain or who's working on your brain. Remember, folks, that what we're doing here is modifying the neurological condition in your brain. You want somebody who can read and write doing this. So my suggestions for anybody who's interested in doing neurotherapy, and there are lots of really, really, really good neurotherapists around in North America and in Europe. First of all, make sure they're licensed to offer a health care service in your jurisdiction. That is, a licensed physician, a licensed psychologist, a licensed chiropractor, etc. The second, make sure they are certified to offer neurotherapy. And certification means a national organization that is not part of the franchise. A lot of these individuals will indicate that they're certified to practice quantum neurotherapy. There are all kinds of phrases they use. And the certification is the agency that's offered the franchise. Finally, and emphatically, not one size fits all. Okay, now with those, I can get off my soapbox and we can get started here. For anybody who's interested in the scientific literature associated with EEG, biofeedback, or neurotherapy generally, as it's called, I invite you to go to the National Library of Medicine database, click in that that website, and there are at present around 700 publications just associated with neurotherapy. Secondarily, if you go to the International Society for Neuronal Regulation, ISNR.org, and click on their database that was compiled by Dr. Corey Hammond. You can find a lot of very specific information for specific disorders, ADD, depression, etc. Okay, now, the first thing we're going to do is talk about what kind of capability neurotherapy has. This is neurotherapy for a stroke person, and these data were provided by Dr. Tom Budzinski, who unfortunately passed away a month or so ago. And this is a comparison of the handwriting of somebody who is in rehab doing neurotherapy for a stroke. And you can see before neurotherapy what the handwriting looked like, halfway through neurotherapy and after neurotherapy. So you have clear evidence here of regaining of fine motor skill. Now, we jerry-rigged something so that you folks can hear some sound bites that have come off my answering machine. The first is a message left by a woman who had a first session for post-traumatic stress disorder. First treatment for a post-traumatic stress disorder condition. By the way, her reference to jumping over buildings, and I was comparing her with Superman, where she was talking about jumping over small buildings after treatment. The second is a traumatic brain injury client, and the first clip here is before treatment has started, and the second clip is after she's about halfway through treatment, roughly 11 treatments. Now, what I'd like you to do is focus on the quality of the voice so you can get an idea of what neurotherapy can do in these kinds of brain injury, stroke kinds of conditions.
I'm not going to be able to make a 9 o'clock appointment. We're still figuring out the appearance for Watson. I'll call you back and make appointments for next week. Bye.
And now this is the second.
I'm calling to make an appointment for next week, Thursday at 11 o'clock. If that's not good, could you give me a call back and let me know which would be a good time? Thank you.
Okay, now that gives you an idea of what neurotherapy can do at a neurological level. We're going to go over some of the conditions that we treat with neurotherapy. But this is a good time to refer back to my very first slide. Anything that has this kind of capability also has the capability for very serious side effects. And we get a lot of casualties from these one-size-fits-all franchises that have popped up. The person who's messing around with your brain better know what he's doing, he or she is doing. You don't want one-size-fits-all franchises. And this is a letter that I received some time ago from a mother of a child that we treated 8 years previous to this letter. And the only reason I'm putting this up on the screen is that we hear a lot of comments about neurotherapy doesn't last, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Here's 8 years post-treatment, in which she says that at the time of treatment, her young child was a year and a half behind in the schooling. Today, she was awarded a pin in recognition of her academic achievements for her grade 10. She's extremely proud of her 4-point grade average. Okay. Now, The name of this program, the title we use for this program is It's All in Your Head. What stimulated that was I had a lot of clients who would show up, we're kind of end of the road treaters here, and they've been through all kinds of things, and people have just thrown up, the treaters just thrown up their hands and said, well, you know, go off to a psychiatrist, this is all in your head. So they show up on my doorstep and they make that statement, you know, that they were told it's all in their head. And my statement, my response to that is, of course, where else would it be? Of course it's in your head. Now, having said that, neurologically, all of these conditions are associated with brain functioning. So we can treat things like mood disorders and depression, any of the addictions and dependencies, any of the appetitive disorders, any of the anxiety disorders, head injury, as you've just experienced with some of the slides we've put on, seizure disorders. We do a lot of work with epilepsy and so forth. Developmental and learning conditions, autism, Asperger's, sleep problems, chronic pain, of course, and, of course, the ADD, ADHD, oppositional defiance kind of problems. We also do a lot of work in optimal performance. We have a lot of CEOs who come in and keep their brain really sharp, and most of the Canadians who won a gold medal at the Olympics did neurotherapy. It was considered their secret weapon. The team that won the World Cup in soccer, the last time around, the Italian team, every man on the team did neurotherapy. Okay. The initial brain assessment. The first thing we do when a person walks in the door is we evaluate brain functioning. Now, there are various levels to this. For simple problems, excuse me, like depression, sleep problems, anxiety problems, attention deficit disorder, and so forth, for simple problems like that, we do a very brief five points on the brain, brain assessment. Somebody come in with a stroke, closed head injury, epilepsy, and so forth. Then we go to a full brain map. That is, we put a cap right over the head and measure all 19 sites simultaneously. What we're looking at is brain activity. And the brain is generating a lot of electrical activity as it's functioning. And each one of these waveforms has a different implication, again, depending upon where you are in the brain. Delta, around 2 cycles a second, a very slow wave, and it's associated with sleep. It's also associated with pain and head injury, that is, when it's appearing when it shouldn't. Theta waves, 3 to 7 cycles a second, kind of has this look to it, and again, depending upon where in the brain you are, it can be associated with quieting. It can be associated with inattentiveness. It can be associated with some pain functions as well, depending upon where it is. Alpha, very important waveform. And we'll talk about alpha a little later on when we're looking at the treatment of severe emotional trauma. Alpha waves are very symmetrical, 8 to 12 cycles a second. It kind of looks like this. Beta waves are very fast. 16 to 25 cycles a second. And that's usually when the brain is functioning, when that area of the brain is functioning, you know, like in attentiveness and focused concentration. And if we combine all the waves, if we're doing a full CAP, that is all 19 sites simultaneously, this is what it looks like on the screen as we're measuring the brain. For the simple problems, you know, depression and ADD and so forth, these are the 5 sites that we look at. We look at the back of the brain, and the reason we look at the back of the brain is that's an area associated with quieting and sleep and the ability of the brain to heal and restore itself. experience meditate is what they're doing, is they're increasing slow frequency in that area of the brain. Up over the sensory motor cortex, right on top of the head, that's an area associated with sensation, perception, motor movements. A lot of ADD clients, you'll find that there's too much slow activity up there. And then right across the frontal cortex, the frontal part of the brain, the executive portion, implicated in everything in some way. Now, when folks come to see me, typically I don't ask them why they've come. I do a brain assessment and I tell them why they're sitting in front of me, because the brain does tell us everything. And this is a comment from a book written by Susan Olding, who is reporting on the issues that she had in trying to get adequate treatment for her daughter. And this is where she describes having come in to see me for the initial assessment. One of the statements she made is that she tried to hand me the medical and developmental history, and I, as you can see, made a big deal about not looking at them. And then after I did the assessment here, and he pointed to an outline of the brain, these numbers imply trauma. One by one, he read the ratio dividing my daughter more quickly, more accurately than any professional I'd yet encountered. Now, that's the power of brain assessment. If you have an adequate database and you are working with somebody who knows how to evaluate normative brain functioning. Okay, so we are going to be talking about various areas of the brain, and we're going to be focusing primarily on the more limited five-point assessment. Now, we're going to be looking at activities on the right side of the front part of the brain, on the left side of the front part of the brain, up over the sensory motor cortex, up in this region here, and then in the back of the brain as well. And this is the quieting and the sleep area. And then one of the electrodes, as you recall, is sitting right in the center, right up here, and that's over an area of the brain referred to as the anterior cingulate gyrus, and that's associated with obsessive compulsive kinds of behaviors, willfulness, passiveness, and so forth.
And this is our first break. Before we start answering your questions, I'd like to mention that we run monthly newsletters and we also send event announcements, like when the next webcast will be. And if you'd like to stay informed, make sure your name is on our mailing list. And if it's not, you can go to our website, www.swingleandassociates.com, and subscribe to our newsletter right on the homepage. Okay, first question. Thank you, Dr. Swingle, for presenting these talks. I find them very informative. My question, can you treat very young infants?
Yes. One of the procedures that I developed when I was at McLean Hospital is referred to as brain driving. And this is a procedure in which we do not need the cooperative or the volitional, the volition of the client. We can measure a particular aspect of brain functioning and stimulate the brain in various ways to get it to nudge it into more normative functioning. Actually, I think today I have a slide of treatment of a four-month-old child who had a very serious seizure disorder.
How much does your treatment cost, and is it paid for by the provincial plan?
In British Columbia, it is not covered by the provincial plan, but it's a function of who gives the treatment. If the treatment is given by a registered psychologist, such as myself, for example, it is covered by extended medical programs. Now, this varies from jurisdiction to jurisdiction. And there are some areas in which neurotherapy is actually covered under the government plans. The cost in my clinic will differ or could differ substantially from other clinics. But the intake assessment for simple problems runs about $200 Canadian dollars. For serious stroke, closed head injury, that sort of thing, The full cap is probably closer to 500. And then the treatments vary anywhere from 115 up to about 150. And for garden variety kinds of simple problems like depression, you're probably looking at 15 to 18 sessions as a rule of thumb. Head injury, different issue. We really don't know until we see how the brain starts to respond. And people sometimes are in the long haul there where we're working collaboratively with physiotherapists and so forth. So that might go over a more extended period of time.
Are there any other ways to make the brain change other than your treatment?
Oh, sure. I mean, folks have been doing this for centuries. A lot of this came from having a look at how meditators are able to change brain functioning. So some of the work that was done at the Menninger Foundation in the United States, in Kansas, looked at the brain activity of these very experienced meditators. And they had their resident gurus there. And we found that we could do what these meditators might take 10 years to do in about 10 weeks or so. So there are lots of things you can do. What we advise for the elderly who are starting to have some age-related declines is get your brain engaged, and it will make a difference. Meditation makes a difference. So, yeah, there are lots of things. Neurotherapy is a highly technologically precise method for modifying very specific areas in the brain. There are other things you can do. If you're depressed, get up, get active, get yourself lots of light. So, yeah, there are lots of other things you can do.
And another question. Dr. Swingle, anxiety disorders can interfere with attention? I mean, a problem with attention can really be an anxiety problem.
Oh, absolutely. We commonly get children come in who are diagnosed with ADD. And what we find is a severe deficiency in the occipital region of the brain, the back of the brain, which basically the child can't find the switch to turn the brain off. So they have poor stress tolerance, predisposition to anxiety, often sleep quality problems in adults, self-medicating behavior, and so forth. Now, the problem there is they're reading, they get the end of the paragraph, realize they've been thinking about 50 things other than what they're reading. Of course they can't concentrate. It's just a problem of chatter and overload. But, you know, we treat it, we know the precision of neurotherapy is we can identify that. Okay, this is an ADD. You definitely don't want to give them a brain stimulant, obviously. So what you do is you go to the area of inefficiency, correct it, and the attention problem improves.
Okay, we are going to move right on. I just wanted to let you know we have one more break. So if you would like to get your questions answered, please send them to me right now so we can get to them during our second and last break.
Okay, we were just talking about attention deficit and learning disorders. This is a EEG clip of a ADHD child and a child without any ADD issues, that is, lack of a better term, normal. Now, what I draw your attention to, by the way, the source of this is Dr. Othmer. He provided these data. This is the raw signal, okay? So if you look at this, you can see just visually that there's a marked difference between the raw signal of the normal child and the raw signal of the ADHD child. Now, if we break that down and look into low frequency, theta, 3 to 7 cycles a second, we can see there's a profound difference in the theta amplitude. It is considerably greater in the hyperactive child than it is in the non-hyperactive child. And further, and you don't seem to see it in the intermediate frequency, but in the high frequency, again, you see that there's a reduction in the amplitude of the elevated high frequency, 16 to 25 cycles a second, in the hyperactive child. Now, the ratio that we use to identify this is the ratio of the intensity of the slow frequency divided by the intensity of the high frequency, referred to as the theta-beta ratio. Now, this is an example of a child that we treated. She had a theta-beta ratio of 3.5 over the top of the brain, right in the center of the brain. Anything above 2.3 or so for somebody her age would be indicative of an attention problem. Now, there are several things about this slide I want to point out. First of all, when we first start treatment, oh my goodness, it looks like things are getting worse. Okay? All of a sudden, she gets it. Okay? And now she's in a range that's well within normal limits. This is the level we received from the mother. And talking about this client, she started a new school, and after only 1 week in her new school, she brought her violin in to play a solo for her new classmates, and she wasn't even nervous about it. Last year at this time, that would have been impossible. Now, the reason I'm putting this on is that when you change the ADD issue in a child, you change their self-esteem. You change their self-esteem, you change everything. Now, the ADD that we're talking about in that slide and in that EEG clip has to do with elevated slow frequency right here in this area of the brain. So it's right across the top, and it was elevated slow frequency in that region. And that is a very common form of attention deficit disorder. And by decreasing the elevated slow frequency and increasing the fast frequency, in other words, decreasing the theta-beta ratio, just as we saw in the last slide, that's the way you treat ADD without any dangerous drugs whatsoever. Depression and anxiety. I love this cartoon. However, depression is no laughing matter. Now, I'm just showing you a raw data sheet here. These are the numbers that I collect. And I love to look at the raw data and do my own calculations. But we have now programs that will do all of these calculations for the therapist, calculate them all, and give the therapist the markers for the remarkable findings here. But what I want to point out is, and this is the difference between the right side of the brain and the left side of the brain. And you can see that the difference here is about, almost 60%, okay? That's the marker for depression, okay? Now, you're not seeing it here. This is alpha, 8 to 12 cycles a second, very balanced. And this is theta, 3 to 7 cycles a second. This is beta, very fast activity in the brain. And the right side of the brain is much more active than the left. That's the cardinal marker for depression. Now, there are many, 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 many forms of depression, but this is one of the common ones that we see. And we can treat that directly by correcting that imbalance, again, without any dangerous drugs whatsoever. Now, if we're looking at a full topographical representation, now this is the full brain map now, and what we're looking at here is 3 to 7 cycles a second, which again is theta, And what we're looking at is how strong it is. And you can see that the colors here represent the strength of that waveform. So red and white means that's extremely high levels of slow frequency up over the left side of the brain, another marker for depression. And this is fast activity, 15 to 30 cycles a second, beta, marked elevation of theta, I'm sorry, of beta amplitude in the occipital region in the brain, the cardinal marker for anxiety. So this is anxiety and depression. Okay? And we used to call it agitated depression and so forth and so on. But you can see exactly where you have to go in order to correct this condition. So, let me back up here. If the right is more active than the left, that's one of the markers for depression. If you have too much fast activity back here, that can be associated with anxiety, poor sleep, poor stress tolerance, but it also can be an attention problem, problem with concentrating. You just can't get your brain to quiet down. You can't find peace in your own head. You can't shut the brain off. So children that experience this, and adults too, of course, just have a huge problem with trying to concentrate. Now, what I just showed you was where the left side of the brain had excessive amount of slow frequency. Now, when the left has excessive slow frequency, it means that the right is more active than the left. It's another marker for depression. That's why doing a brain assessment, having a good idea of what it is you're doing, where you're going in the brain, and what the markers are for these things. And you can have very, very efficient treatment when you go to a certified, qualified, licensed health professional to help you deal with this. Now, the other thing I want to comment on is that neurotherapy is not a standalone discipline. That's why these one-size-fits-all franchises are so ludicrous. If you come in with depression, you go to an individual who has many other options available for treating your condition. Neurotherapy is one of them. And it may be a combination of things that are used to help you efficiently and rapidly deal with these conditions.
Okay, and we'll go straight to your questions. Actually, let's take a minute break here. I'll play some nice music for you.
It's not that unusual when everything is beautiful. It's just another ordinary miracle today. The sky knows when it's time to snow. Don't need to teach a seed to grow. It's just another.
That, by the way, is Sarah McLachlan, who, and that musical selection was recorded at the Olympics here in Vancouver. And That's kind of our theme song for Neurotherapy, Just Another Ordinary Miracle.
Yes, I hope you enjoyed it. Okay, first question. What instrumentation do you use and how expensive is that?
We have all of the platforms here and things that are used for home treatment. When we send a unit home with clients and then we treat them from our office, that setup would run about $2,000. The brain mappers, now I'm not talking about the computers now. The brain mappers, you're up in the $5,000 to $10,000 range. Some of the basic entry-level clinical level devices, you're in the $2,000 to $3,000 range. Now, that's just for the EEG. It's not for a lot of the other supplementary equipment that may be required for brain driving and things of that nature.
Does neurotherapy help with autism spectrum disorders, and how many sessions are needed?
We see a huge number of children on the ASD dementia. And we're one of the few clinics in North America that accept extremely severe cases. The number of sessions varies tremendously, obviously, depending upon severity. When you're dealing with high-functioning autism or Asperger's, you might be dealing with 15 or 18 sessions to get some very significant improvements. And we're always working with other individuals like RDI therapists or ABA therapists and so forth. For severe conditions, we have clients that we've seen for 5 years. And the parents keep coming back because they continue to see improvements associated with the neurotherapy component of what they're doing. Now, that's not the only thing they're doing. I want to really emphasize that. That if you are dealing with a problem as severe as ASD, you're throwing everything at it, not just neurotherapy. You're doing home treatment. You're doing special tutoring. You're doing some home consultations for RDI or ABA and so forth.
How frequent might treatments be for an adult with traumatic brain injury, and what is the treatment, electrical stimulation?
I'll be getting into how we actually treat this in just a few minutes, but for traumatic brain injury, again, typically we're in the long haul here, a long period of time, and we work with the folks that are going to rehab centers or doing physiotherapy. We also do some physiotherapy here as part of treatment, which is referred to as tasking. That is, while the area of the brain associated with that disorder is under treatment, the individual is performing some sort of motor activity.
Can you explain what is optimal performance and what do you do in this particular?
Sure. Optimal performance for an athlete, for example, first thing we do is the brain assessment I just showed you and take care of any anomalous brain activity. You know, the individual may have a sleep issue, a depression or anxiety, whatever. Take care of that and then once you've done that, then there are some things we can do to increase, basically you're increasing IQ, you're increasing brain efficiency. And typically what we do is we improve the ability of the brain to go in and out of rest. That's really what it amounts to. So we speed up what's called the alpha frequencies, and we make the alpha enhance and alpha blunting more efficient, that is sharper. It's the old rule of thumb. You know, you make sure the foundation is okay before you build the house. And I went to a dentist a few weeks ago and said, first thing we have to do is make sure the foundation's okay before we do any reconstruction. So he used this exactly the same metaphor, you know, prepare the ground before you build the building.
Okay, and we'll take one last question. If we'll have a few minutes at the end of the webcast, we'll try to address the rest. But right now, we only have time for one more. And the question is, can long-term exposure, and I mean years, to computer gaming cause brain inefficiency?
we treat a lot of internet addiction. Internet addiction is a very severe problem now. We have kids who have lost an entire year of university because of addiction. We have individuals who've lost their jobs because of internet addiction. In terms of the radiation and problems on eyes, that's a different issue. And you hear all kinds of notions about the that exposure function, but exposure to the content the internet addictive properties, I think, in my own judgment, are extraordinarily detrimental. So one of the first things I ask every parent is how much screen time are we dealing with? And that screen time is solitary TV watching and computer use. Speaking of optimal performance training, one of the things that happens when you do neurotherapy is you get smarter, as we say. This is something that came from Dr. Lubar, who is one of the giants in the field. And this is simply the results of the WISC, the Wechsler Intelligence Test, for children after neurotherapy. So you can see the pre-assessment, and this is the post-assessment, and you can see every one of the subscales improves. The average he cites here is 15 data points, 15 IQ points, and the everybody who does work with children, the Thompsons in Toronto, Vincent Thassen in New York, Dr. Lubar in Florida, and so forth and so on, all of them find exactly the same thing. Gains between 10 and 18 IQ points when you do neurotherapy. Now, applying this to the athlete or applying this to the CEO, you're making the brain more efficient. In other words, you're getting greater brain capacity as associated with making it more efficient. ASD, the Autistic Spectrum Disorders. This is a book written by Arlene Martel of a child that we saw very early on who had both epilepsy and autism, and both of these things we treated. We treated the seizure disorder and the autism. Now, as many people know, there's a high correlation between autism and seizure disorders. It's 8 or 9 times what it is in the general population. So that it's very frequently you find this combination. This is an enormously courageous woman. She was told when Adam was a very, very young child to put him in a crash helmet and institutionalize him. She said nonsense, and she started on her long, long, long quest. And this is Adam in a tuxedo graduating from high school. He's now in university. And she talks about, in this book, about her experiences with me, among other things. And she also talks about all the other things she did, you know, the ketogenic diets and so forth and so on, associated with how she got Adam to that position. We see a lot of children with autism here and a lot of children with epilepsy, and adults too, of course. Now, I'm going to be going over how we actually do neurotherapy, but one of the things I want to point out is when you're dealing with a severe autistic child, you need a different kind of procedure in order to be able to treat this child who is very likely not to be the least bit attentive or cooperative. Okay. Now, when you're dealing with autism, what you're often dealing with is marked elevations of slow frequency in this region in the brain, a disparity between these areas in the brain, which are associated with the emotional content of verbalization, and who often find, among other things, a real problem here in the right prefrontal orbital cortex. That's where theory of the self resides. Now, there's a big difference between autism and Asperger's. Autism, the reason the child doesn't look you in the eye is you don't exist. And the area in that I have the marker on here is where the theory of the self resides. That is where people recognize other individuals as human emotional beings. The Asperger's child typically has some problems in this area, but there are problems associated with social skill acquisition. So that child recognizes you as an emotional being, but they can't interact with you because they don't have the social skill capabilities. How do we do it? Okay, now, when we're dealing with somebody who can participate volitionally, what we do is we set it up so that when the brain is doing what we want it to do, the client hears a tone or sees something move on the computer monitor. So, for example, in this case, we have an electrode sitting right on top of the head, and these are the references so that we're comparing this position versus this. These are differential amplifiers, and it's giving you the difference between these two sites. So the difference between these two sites, it's filtering out all of the body electrical noise, and the difference there is the brainwave. Now, in this particular case, for example, what we're trying to do is drive down slow frequency amplitude. So we set it up so that when the strength or amplitude intensity of theta, 3 to 7 cycles a second, drops below the training threshold, this icon moves on the screen, and the person hears tone. And it might look something like this. Okay, so that they're running a spaceship through a maze, and, if the brain doesn't do what we want it to do, it stops. Brain does what we want it to do, it starts up again. Okay, so we have all kinds of games for kids, a variety of different things, so that they're able to get bugs to move across a screen and rockets to fire and so forth and so on. There's an important point here, and that is very inexperienced neurotherapists often make a mistake with regard to games and kids. You know, if you start a kid on this kind of game, a seriously ADD child, okay, they're going to fiddle with this for 5 minutes or so. Then they're going to say, I'm bored. Okay, what do you do now? Do you get another game, a more stimulating game? Big mistake. You become part of the problem. What this child is trying to do is trying to learn how to concentrate on the conditions in which the environment is not providing the stimulation. Okay? This is why internet is so addictive with these kids, because it constantly ups the ante in terms of stimulation. Okay? Now, with adults, very often we actually give them the raw signal like this, so that we tell them what we want them to do is to increase the frequency or amplitude in this particular region, for example. Or these are thermometer-like scales, and we tell them that we want to keep this, say, below that training threshold. So this is a visual feedback that they have to try to keep that that bar graph below the training threshold. Trauma. Okay. Just told me this, I don't know, a few weeks ago, I guess, that the experience that she had was so much healing with so few words. I think she said she got that from a book somewhere or other, but in any event, what she meant was we were dealing with the treatment of trauma, which you can see on a brain assessment, by releasing it, so to speak, with neurotherapy. Now, when you release a trauma, neurologically, what happens is the person has an emotional reaction, an emotional abreaction. They may dream more about their trauma situation, may have it on the front burner for a while. They may have a full-blown emotional abreaction, which they break down. This is where the one-size-fits-all clowns are so dangerous, because what they don't know what to do with this, for openers, and they're not trained in dealing with these kinds of traumatic conditions. And a lot of folks are not really aware that an event that they may be fully aware of, have full memory of, is causing them a lot of difficulty, and neurologically it may be released. I'm going to show you what this actually looks like in terms of a raw signal. This is a normal brain, okay? So what we have here, this is the raw signal, theta, alpha, and beta, okay? But what I want you to show you here is the spectrum. This is slow frequency, okay, 2 cycles a second up to probably 30 or so. I can't read, 40, I guess it is. Okay, and this is what it should look like, something like that. There's an algorithm here that intensity is inversely related to amplitude. So the high amplitude have the slowest, the high frequencies have the lowest amplitude. The low frequencies have the highest amplitude. That's kind of what it should look like. Okay. This is what we call an alpha response. Now, what's going to happen, this is eyes open, what's going to happen is this person's going to close their eyes and you're going to see a big jump in alpha right in this region here once the eyes get closed. And there it is. Okay. So there's the normal alpha response, as we say. Close your eyes, get a nice jump in alpha. And this is measured in the back of the brain now. And then when you open your eyes again, it should drop like a stone. And here it comes now. There it goes. Okay, so there's the alpha enhance and the alpha blunting, as we say. There's a tremendous amount of information there. Poor alpha blunting, age-related decline in memory. And this is trauma. Now, just look at the difference here. And you can see it. I mean, it just screams at you. First of all, you'll notice that the spectrum there is much flatter, you know, much less slow frequency. See, there the alpha seems like it's trying to get up and it just can't get the job done, right? So there's trauma. Okay. Now, the way we release that, one of the ways is brain driving. Now, this is a non-volitional procedure in which the what we do is measure a particular aspect of brain functioning. Based on that measurement, we stimulate with light and sound with kids, microamperage stimulation in EMF fields with adults. Now, this woman is being treated. She's an elderly woman. So we are presenting sound. We're presenting light stimulation. We're presenting electrical stimulation of acupuncture points. Okay. This is pericardium 6, according to Chinese medicine. And I've done a lot of research on this. Stimulating at that point increases slow frequency in the back of the brain. And it is a contingent model, so that when the brain is doing something, we either stimulate or turn off the stimulation to drive the brain, nudge the brain into more normal functional ranges. Now, she has control of the intensity of these things, so there's a feeling of being in control, in the sense that the sound doesn't all of a sudden blast on. You know, you turn it on, so she adjusts it so it's comfortable, and the same is true with the lights. And this is the use of brain driving with a nine-month-old child. Somebody earlier on asked about the treatment of infants, and this is a very serious problem, West syndrome, in terms of seizure problems with a child. This goes well beyond what I wanted to cover in terms of today, but this is the number associated with vulnerability to seizure. This is the theta SMR ratio, sensory motor rhythm ratio, which you can see on the brain maps. And we want this below 3 or so, and you can see where it is. Now, we use brain driving on this child, and this is where we were able to bring that ratio using brain driving, which is a non-volitional procedure, so we can use it with infants. And this is the number of seizures reported by the parents, seizure-free days. When they started, child had a seizure every day, and lots of them. After 4 weeks of treatment, 45% seizure-free days. After treatment, 100% seizure-free days during the 11th week. Now, they flew in from the Orient someplace, so we did intensive treatment over a 12-week period, and sent the child back with some methods that they could use at home to sustain the gains. One of the things that we do is we have a number of things that we can give people to use at home to sustain the gains of treatment. Omni is a harmonic that sounds like shh, that drives down slow frequency amplitude, and we use it for sustaining treatment gains with ADD children. So for this, was provided by Dr. Othmer, and this is the hyperactive child, marked elevation of slow frequency and deficiency of fast frequency. This is what the Omni harmonic will do, and these data came from Dr. Budzinski, who tested one of my one of these harmonics, and here's the slow frequencies, the ones that are the problem in the ADD child, and you can see it's suppressing the strength of those slow frequencies. There's your theta, and it is increasing the faster frequency. It's a perfect treatment for this condition. You're driving this down, which is exactly what you want to do. And a PhD student of mine did a doctoral thesis on this particular harmonic, and he found that you actually do get gains from the harmonic itself above and beyond the neurotherapy. It's trivial, you know, it's about a 0.5% a week, but the important thing is it sustains the gains that we make in treatment, and this is the kind of harmonic that we use for brain driving. When the brain is producing too much slow frequency, we turn on that harmonic, drive it down. When it gets into better shape, we turn the harmonic off. So that's what brain driving is all about. Okay, well, we have come very close to the end. This is the book that I wrote that was published by Rutgers University Press that explains a lot of these sorts of things, and it's written for, you know, folks who, parents who want to bring their kids in and so forth. And this is the clinician's guide for folks who are clinicians, licensed healthcare professionals who want to have a hard look at what neurotherapy can do in as an added treatment option in their practices.
Okay, well, like Dr. Svengel said, we are at the end of our webcast. We won't have chance to answer the rest of your questions, unfortunately, but feel free to send me your questions or comments to my email address, which is rita@svengelandassociates.com. It's the same email address you use to get the information to log in to this webcast. And this is another slide. Dr. Swingel does workshops about GWQ and brain driving. He travels all over the world. This year, he's been a few times in Europe. We've done some in North America. And we are actually going to be doing one here at our clinic. We plan for March 2012. So for all the professionals out there, if you are interested to attend the workshop, let me know and I will give you all the details. Well, thank you everyone for being with us today. We hope you enjoyed it and we'll be looking forward to meet you again on Sunday when Dr. Swingel will discuss age-related declines. Have a good weekend, everyone. Bye-bye.